Tell me about him.
Oh, well, Bob is, you know, when we were writing the movie, it was easy to sort of, we tried to reach out to him, and he wasn't willing to participate in the writing of the movie, or at least give us, you know, a little bit of his perspective on it. But later on, when he called Andrew, you know, we went to meet him in Los Angeles, and I remember walking up and feeling like, you know, my heart was pumping away, and I was sort of, wow, I've been studying this guy for 3 or 4 years now, and I've studied the bad and the good of him. And but once you sit down with him, you know, you very quickly, I think this is probably true with most people, you very quickly put aside your what you preconceive of what he is, and you see who the person is, and he's charming, he's funny, he's self-deprecating. You know, he has weird quirks, and
like,
you know,
what?
Well, he blinks a lot, yeah. And he burps, and he does things I think that are probably most people would find, you know, they wouldn't want to do, but he seems to be his own man in that way. He does what he wants.
And I mean, how did he get away with crime?
Well, the murder in Texas is the only one he was tried for.
Right.
So he got away because, you know, he pled self-defense, and he convinced the jury that that was the case. He had very good legal counsel.
Yeah.
Dick DeGaren's a top, top, top Texas lawyer, a very smart guy. He had a team, actually, of Texas lawyers. In the film, at one point, he admits that he hired them all because, you know, everybody had recommended the top people. He just hired everybody.
Why should we care about him?
Well, I think this is a kind of an amazing, unique human story, but it also is happening on a kind of operatic level. You know, you're dealing with a family that has a tremendous reach. They're quite a private family, and yet enormously powerful. You know, this is not a family that's building a local apartment building. They're building the Bank of America Tower, the Condé Nast building, the Freedom Tower on the site of the World Trade Center. So it's an important family, and it's an important and unusual story. You very seldom have somebody who's been accused of this kind of series of grisly crimes, who's also the scion of this enormously powerful family. Well, you know, people sometimes say when we talk about what we're working on, they say, you know, does Bob know what you're doing? Because they know we've been working on this for years.
Yeah.
And I always say, does he know what we're doing? It was his idea. You know, if you think about it, Bob saw our film about him and reached out to me and said, I would like to talk.
This is the motion picture film.
People would say Ryan Gosling playing him in a movie and thought that we had painted a relatively sympathetic portrait of him, at least a fair portrait of him. And he called and said, look, nobody's ever really understood me before. I've seen the movie. I cried 3 times. It's an emotional movie. I would like to talk more to you. And we got together with him and his lawyer.
It must have been a good day for you.
It was fascinating. I mean, I called Mark and I said, hey, guess who I just got a phone call from? But the first meeting was very interesting with his lawyer because we got together here in New York. And I had met with a lawyer a couple times and with Bob a few times. And the lawyer sat down and said, Bob, you've asked me to look at what Andrew wants to do and to think about what I think about it. I know what you've considered, sitting down, doing an interview about your life, kind of no holds barred. And I've come to the conclusion, I think this is the worst idea I've ever heard in my life. It's a terrible idea. You should never do it. Number one, you've been falsely accused of 3 murders over 30 years. You have your liberty. You're wandering around. You're wealthy and happy. There's nothing that sitting down with a filmmaker and participating in a kind of grueling interview is going to do to improve your life. First of all, remember, he called me.
I know he did.
And so he must have thought
there
was something.
But he has a lawyer weighed in and say, this is the dumbest, this is the worst idea.
And what
you
he said...
You can get nothing good out of this.
I think what he said is no different than what any of us might think, which is nobody wants to die without telling their story.
Yeah, that's true.
And Bob has had his story told over 30 years by every tabloid. You know, and it's frustrating because his family, this very powerful family, they do tons of work and they'll spend 30 years assembling some giant parcel of real estate and they'll build something. And if they're lucky, they'll get a small article in the New York Times about it. Bob shows up and buys a bagel at Zabar's and he's on the front page of the Post. And it says he's back with a giant picture. So I think Bob is used to having people do a sort of a burlesque version of his life. And I think he craved having somebody do this kind of a deep dive. And knowing that we would do the work, that we would actually do the work to understand what truly happened.
You mean you would come in and do the homework and have an open mind?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He said, I guess to you, you know, that I think of myself as someone who was born with a burden that I couldn't carry.
Yeah. Well, I said to him, you know, some people say that you are the unluckiest guy in the world because you lost your beloved wife. you lost your best friend in Los Angeles, and you lost your neighbor who was your good friend, your elderly across the hall neighbor in Galveston, Texas. And other people say you're the luckiest guy in the world because you killed your wife, you killed your best friend, you killed your neighbor, and you got away with it.